Yogesh for accepting our request to come here, share how this organization has really moved to 50 cities. And we thought we can understand and from him, what is the secret behind the success of Jaipur Rugs. We have some few questions, which is quite obvious, I think, and people would like to ask. So the first one is, let's start from the beginning. How the journey of Jaipur Rugs started? Everybody knows Mr. Dhankishore Ji, how he started, but let's hear from you. You are the second generation, and how you are taking it from there. So start from the beginning, and your role, and what's the future vision of this organization. Then I'll come to the specifics, which is more important, right? And then the story. This is the folklore is going, okay, that's future ho gaya. How and where things have happened, changed, we'll ask it later.
Sure. Thank you for having me here. My father started in 1978. Jaipur started in 1999, just to give some perspective. And I was doing my undergraduate in Boston, from Boston College. I never wanted to get into my father's business. I was always a techie, so wanted to do something in the technology space. I got an internship with a startup, tech startup in Boston. And I came to India for a month after I completed 2 years out of the 4, and something went wrong in the office. And some senior people had resigned, so I decided to take a semester off, cancel my internship, spend a semester or two, help my father, and then go back to college. And since then, I never went back, so I'm a college dropout.
So the league of college dropout includes Yogesh also.
And I started with, I took over immediately as I joined in. So I was always into technology and finance. So I took over those functions for my father right away. And he put me into sales also from the first day. So when I joined business, we were a small company, very few customers. And so there was not enough sales work. So I started, you know, my first role was just kind of expanding out. So when I started, we used to work only in the United States and India, and in the last 10 years we've been able to grow that to sell to over 50 countries now. And sales has been my predominant role in the last 10 years. And then we started a lot of value-added engineered products in our company. So I overtook the supply chain of those products also in the company. So I take care of technology, finance, and the marketing side.
So being the CEO or being the person who's at the helm. So sales is the first foremost job which you're looking at.
Yeah, so it's a family business. So fortunately, I have my father who looks after the production, okay, and the foundation that we have. And I have three elder sisters. So two of the eldest one run the American operation.
Okay.
And the third one, she has a design. So we have different skill sets at different levels, which really help.
So now you said two things, which is specialized a lot. Finance and technology. So let's dwell a little bit more. And before that, let me understand. So when you started with full time, what kind of turnover is this organization, and how your involvement or your the next generation involvement has grown this to the next level?
When I joined, the company's turnover was about 18 crores, and we're close to 150 crores in sales now. Yeah.
And so this was in how many years? This is 10 years, 15 years?
10 years. Yeah.
So from 15 to 150.
Almost.
So around 10 times of growth in 10 years' time. Any other organization here who have done this? Great, sir. So we need to talk to him also and understand his values on that part. So how does you finance this growth? Where is the financial discipline come in, and what are the financial tools you use to ensure that you are able to grow in 10 years' time?
So we took a two-step approach. Our business involves a lot of working capital. So fortunately, we were able to get working capital from the banks. And all the profits that we're generating were reinvesting into infrastructure and also some part of the working capital. So during the 2010s, I remember 2009-10, we went through a really bad time because our debt, just to give you some perspective, on a revenue of 65 crores, our debt was 45 crores. And the bank started to say that we cannot finance a company anymore. So, you know, we started to become a little more disciplined, you know, since then, in terms of financial planning. And so finance is never easy. You know, during the 2008 to 10 period, I must have reached out to at least 20 VCs from the World Banks to International Finance Corporations to a lot of venture capitals we were going to raise money. And we in fact also got an offer. And the way that guy talked to me, I didn't like. So I said, you know, I don't want this guy's money. You know, I'd rather work harder and survive somehow and start from scratch. And I think it was a good decision. They made an offer for buying 10-20% stake in the company at an X price.
We had a session in the morning and everybody was there. The challenge of getting being funded from banks and all. I mean, the people are talking about it's very difficult to get funds. Share your experience and share how you are able to generate this funding from the banks. What are the things you have done in your organization which has helped you to get this fund? Maybe easier. At a time when you require it instead of anything else?
I mean, I think a lot of people who are starting first generation always have much more difficulty than the second generation. So, you know, with me it was a little easier because we still had some assets to pledge and other things. So there the whole, when you have assets, the bank is much more comfortable giving you loan. But when my father started and he was growing, he shares his experiences how you know, the bank you know, would not really finance easily. So what he did was he organically grew. So he started from very scratch with two looms, and then every year he would increase that. So I mean, I think even if he had finance, he would have grown much faster, much quicker. But he did not have access to finance, and because of that, you know, obviously the growth was much limited. So he was only reinvesting the profits that he was making into the business.
So one of the key takeaways I think is that reinvesting your profit so that you can increase your capital and increase your profit slowly and gradually.
And also with banks, you know, I've been dealing with them for almost 10 years. I think the bank is always looking for comfort from the entrepreneur. So I've seen it a lot of times where bank is more comfortable giving finance on the exact same plan to one entrepreneur where they feel more comfortable. So I think it is your duty to talk to the bank managers and tell them about your plan, ask them to visit, show them how it's going to work. You know, in our case also that made a lot of difference. So the bank, when I was telling you during the slowdown times, they had literally pulled that case, bhai, aap jabal ko finance karna difficult ho jayega, aapka account NPA kar denge, like, you know, that will, you're going through a very difficult financial situation. What I started to do was, all the local managers and all, I started to call them to the office. I told them, this is the situation. We're not running away. We're going through a hard time. So, you know, we did a lot of communication. So, you know, and what I realized was that before the communication, they were all very harsh in terms of that, you know, ye kar do, wo kar do, ye ho sakta hai. It was always a threatening. After that, everything changed. After that, it was about ki, acha, kya ho raha hai, how can, they were almost like a part of the journey. And I've seen that with one of my other colleagues also, who runs a very successful business now. And he was running around banks, and you know, he couldn't really get finance, so he was running off equity which he couldn't find enough. And then he started to build a relationship with the bank, and you know, now the bank funds him, and he was fortunately able to do very well just by convincing them, showing them what he does. He made the bank as one of his first customers. So he was giving them a service, and then you know it became easier for the bank also to fund them. So there are different ways, but I think relationship is very critical with banks to get finance.
That's another takeaway I think everybody should look at and think about it, is that how you can build relationship with the banks and the people in the bank so that they know your business and you are very transparent in it. Transparency is something which I think is one of the key things. And share, you can do what I am and this is what we can make the payment. Fine. Now this is rugs or carpets. This is very much more of a labor intensive work. Where does technology play a role in this? And how do you think, you coming from a technology background, have you implemented any technology? How is technology enabling you to grow or propel your business in this current digital era, which as we are talking about?
Technology for us is everywhere. So the designs that we make earlier were all hand-drawn, and those were given to weavers to make. Today, the scale at which we are, without technology, I don't think we can even grow to such a scale. So we digitalized all our designing, and we trained all the people who were traditionally wouldn't even know how to read and write to design on a computer. And then ERP obviously is a very big thing, and for us, you know, we've always been very technologically savvy. So fortunately, we implemented ERP long back ago from Microsoft, and that has been very good. So we have visibility across the supply chain. So our model is such that we make carpets in almost 8 states, and we have very small offices spread across various thousands of homes across the country. And to get visibility there is not easy. And through a very good ERP system, we've been able to connect our customers to the viewer and tell them what the status of a particular rug is. So technology has played a huge role there. And obviously, I think in terms of marketing also, digital is one of our biggest platforms that we market. So there are a lot of our customers that we've never met. One of the strategies that we've always used was to portray ourselves much bigger than how big we are. So when we were a 50 crore company, if you looked at our website, it'll look like a really high end, you know, very big company. And that really helped, because if you're showing to the external world digitally that you have, obviously you have to make a good product, you don't have to lie, but if you put it rightly, it really helps acquire a lot of customers. So for us, it worked really well. We've started e-commerce also now. So just in the US alone, we do over 70 crores worth of product sales online, which is a very big segment for us.
70 crores online. So it saves a lot of cost in terms of manpower, sales team, logistics. Can we just go a little bit more on the ERP? Because I think a lot of organizations are in manufacturing. So can we just dwell about how you implemented ERP? What is the reason why you implemented ERP and the benefit you are getting it? I know you shared something, but if you just dwell a little bit more, that would be definitely good for the audience also. Am I correct? It would be, yeah.
I mean, so we always had a vision of growing much bigger. And data for growing is very important. So you need to have data on the tips. And you need to know what's happening there. And ERP is something that connects everything. So, for us, I cannot imagine how this functions without an ERP. So everything from our website to the stocks to inventory to our finance, everything is on a single platform which is connected. So I don't know if you want to ask anything specific, but I think
it's good if we can get to the specific, because how the entire supply chain is working, how your inventory is managed. And what is the role as one of the key person at the top able to take decisions by this information?
So, as I told you, our inventory is spread across many states in the country. So, whenever we're doing meetings, for us it is very critical to know how much yarn I have. So, for example, in my entire system, I must have around 20,000 kgs of silk yarn, which is almost 4 crore rupees in inventory value. Now this is spread across some, maybe 40 lakhs worth of yarn is in Gujarat, 50 lakhs in UP, 50 lakhs in my store, so it's all spread out. With the help of ERP, with the help of one click, I know exactly the value of my total silk, I know exactly where it is and how much it is. I know exactly how much I wasted and, how much loss I had at dyeing or at weaving or at any other location. So, when we were cutting down, costs, especially in 2008-09, with ERP, we were able to get such accurate, such amazing data where we said, what are the key expenses of the business? Where are the key losses of the business? And what all do we need to do? So I think with ERP, you can get data at clicks of, just at clicks rather than waiting for reports and combining 10 reports. And, so before ERP, we had Tally. So we were doing accounting in Tally. And for inventory, we had another software. And obviously they were not talking to each other, and it was not easy to bring data at that point, bringing value.
So well, it makes sense to invest on the technology so that it can help you and save a lot of money and all. Right. Another thing is, since you have operations and your production in 7-8 locations, how many people are working with you?
So on roles we have over 600 people, but about almost 40,000 artisans work for us.
40,000 artisans across 8 cities and 600 people.
Yeah.
This brings to the main next question, which is again a challenge for most of us. How do you manage your HR? How do you able to retain people? Were you able to retain people? Or you are also a training session with many people. I always talk about, okay, we are very small businesses, we are like a training organization, and people come there, get trained and join an LLC. So how, just let us take us through your HR function in the organization.
Well, if somebody has an answer for that, you know, I'd also like to give. But I think it is very important to understand why are you doing business. And if you have clarity on that, then the answer becomes very easy. Because so for us, we get between 20 and 50 fresh recruits, college graduates every year. So, you know, when we started to professionalize the business a little bit, what we realized was that a lot of the professionals who were coming in had a lot of a mindset which they were already accustomed to on how they were working earlier. So I'm not talking about right or wrong, but the culture in our office was very different. We are a very lean organization. So, you know, a person who's lifting carpets in the showroom has a right to walk into my door any time of the day. When we got professionals, obviously, for them, you know, we hired people from IIM, ISB, and suddenly the first thing they would say, ki bhai, main labor se kyun baat karun? And our culture is completely different. So, we had a lot of failures in hiring. But one thing that we never stopped was training, and I think that's been our biggest success. So people, I think, will always come and go. But when you have one star in the company, that is equivalent to 10 other or 20 other coming and going. So you know that, you know, even today, we invest a lot of money, a lot of energy in training people. So you know. And obviously, we've been able to create some policies which, if you want, I can share, which have really helped us retain people. But I think the key factor has been, you know, like making our employees feel that they're getting a lot of value continuously. So we send them to different programs. You know, we do a lot of internal trainings. Anybody who comes in the company goes through a 3-day induction, then they have product training, then, you know, anybody at any level. And so we realize that. You know, making training people makes a big, has a direct impact on the retention. So a lot of people come, you know, because they feel that, you know, they'll get an opportunity to grow and learn a lot more in our organization. So it becomes a lot easier to retain them.
So one of the key takeaways, I think, is the training of employees.
Absolutely.
It's not a waste of money, which is a lot of people think about it. Okay, why should I invest on this training and if it is the organization?
I think there is no, if you don't train, you will not grow. So, I mean, it's a, and if you fear about them leaving, then you will not be able to grow anyway. So, I think it's a chicken and egg situation there. Yeah.
Right, so you talked about a couple of policies. So, can you just name a few, for 4 or 5, which can be used by all of our colleagues here or members of the team?
Okay, right. So, yeah, we started incentivizing people for staying longer. So, as soon as a fresh graduate joins our company, we have a built-in component of almost 10 to 20%. If they stay for 2 years in the company, they get a bonus of anywhere between 20,000 and 50,000 rupees. You know,
that's big money.
Sorry,
that's big money.
Yeah, it depends upon the level. I'm bigger, like, you know, on senior levels that goes into lakhs. So even if somebody spends 6, 7, 8 months in the company, there's a lot of incentive to not leave the company for a little salary. So you know, a lot of people because of small reasons might leave very quickly. What happened because of that was that if the manager argued with somebody, this guy knows that I have a lot to lose on the table. So I was just, so a lot of times, you know, for very small and minor reasons, people leave. And so that made a huge impact. I think that policy itself helped us quite a bit. Our retention for, and we always prefer hiring fresh graduates. So we take MBAs or undergrads and train them ourselves. And then, you know, we also made a lot of our policies flexible. So we were very rigid on ke time pe aao jao, uske alawa, you know, all the days were okay in our leave policies. So we worked around, we realized that these, the very small things, at the end of the day, matter a lot. So we started doing 2 Saturdays off, we, our annual leaves we increased, you know, we have 15 leaves otherwise. So a lot of small policy level changes.
So you become more human.
Exactly.
Then a normal organization.
So our industry was such that even today, in parts of the industry, employees get 1 day off in a month. Obviously, we, when, you know, I then we were always Sunday and everything off. But then since then, we've really moved. And the idea was not to say that Saturday is off, but the idea is to tell them that we care. And, you know, if you want to do something, you know, so the whole policy system was designed so that the employees, you know, there was cases where people misused it. But it was taken in front of everybody so that, you know, the culture was created such that people don't misuse. Because when you start losing things, you get repercussions also on the other end. And I think that has to do a lot with the culture you create in the company. And if you're able to hold your managers accountable to make sure something like that is not happening. So there's no right answer. I think we're also as a company still figuring out. And I think that's the biggest challenge and opportunity for any company. But yeah.
Okay, let me open this questions to the audience. So if you have any questions, please. Yeah.
Yeah. Which ERP you are using right now? It's SAP or?
No, we use Microsoft's Dynamic NAV, NAV.
So it has BI analytics in it.
You can get BI on the site. It's not included in the base. Yeah. So Microsoft ka, they have policies. So you keep buying modules, licenses.
Any other questions?
On the lighter side, I mean, a gentleman of his status, when he came, really it was...
you already
Yeah, really it was difficult to believe that a person of his status has come. So on the lighter side, does a entrepreneur of his status be in a state in which he is with less polished shoes, very ordinary clothes, daadi badi hui hai, and absolutely like nobody. Is that also a prerequisite to become a millionaire?
I think it's a very good question.
We come from very humble backgrounds.
Yeah, that looks like, yes.
And we still eat on the floor, on the carpet. We don't have any fancy cars. So I think it is all about what you want in life. My father chose a life where he gets happiness out of seeing other people grow. And, internal satisfaction hota hai, usse bada life hai, I realize there is nothing. So money can never satisfy you. So, fortunately I have my father who keeps constantly reminding. Today, if you ask him what is the turnover of the company and what is the profit, he has no idea. So, you know, he is a people's person, and I don't think there is any right or wrong in wearing good or bad clothes or looking differently, but, my father definitely is on the other end of the spectrum. So, you know, sometimes you have to tell him that pants change, but he's still like that in the office. So.
Fine. So, before that, any suggestions, any advice which to the fellow entrepreneurs from your end, which you should ask, like us to implement or use from your side or maybe from Anukushoji's side, which people would like to follow us.
So when I joined business, you know, I had a lot of energy about doing something. My father always had this vision of connecting the weaver with the end customer. So his vision was always ki mujhe na jo ye weaver hai isko customer se milwana hai. And when I joined, I was so excited that there is something that, you know, I really want to do. And when I got in business, I realized I got involved into a lot of small nitty-gritties and that was almost lost. So, when I look back now, I think it is very important to always come back a little above and see why was, what are we trying to do and why did we establish something. And that really, really helps. So, you know, in the last 2 years, we've started to put in a lot of effort to bring back the original vision. And start focusing and yielding a lot of results. So I think that is one. And second was persistence, I think. So, you know, we've gone through, from an outside perspective, we look like a great company, you know. It's all good, you know, it's a big company we're doing. But internally, when you look at it, the journey has been very rough. You know, you go through a lot of good and bad times. So I think when I see some of my friends who go through one or two bad times, they close their businesses immediately. So I think the important thing is that business is never one size story. You know, all the successful businesses might look great today, but even today we face a lot of challenges. So I think being persistent is super critical. Because bad time, that is the true test of you know, making sure how much you believe in your own vision. So because if it's a bad time, then it's very easy to say that this is not working and let's run out of it. And I see a lot of people doing that in today's world. So I think that is very critical.
So how, where do you see Jaipur as 10 years from now, 2027? Do you have any targets in that, any vision document ready, anything which you as a entrepreneur is keen to achieve? And
so we measure our success in happiness. And the first, you know, my father always says that I do everything because mujhko khush rehna hai. Main logon ko khush dena chahta hu kyunki khushi se mujhe khushi milti. So I'm very selfish. We do have regular targets, but that is not really critical for us. The more critical part for our organization is to ensure that we keep doing what we were, you know, with the vision that we formed it. So, you know, the vision for the company is that, you know, we want to create products create services where the front is connected with the end of the product. And you know, whatever that might translate into in the future, right now Rugs is just a platform to connect to, but that is the core vision. And obviously one of the critical aspects is that everybody in the value chain should be happy. So, you know, my father always says that when he started, weavers were always mistreated in the industry, but he always treated them like customers. He did the exact opposite, and I think that's been one of the biggest success for the biggest reason for the success. So everybody who didn't look at people who were the most important in the industry, my father focused most on them. The way we service them, deliver them, is completely opposite from the entire industry. So there was a lot of additional cost, but the kind of benefit we derive from it is also just not on a satisfaction level, but also on a business level. It's very hard for other companies to compete on our quality, for example, or deliveries where and that's directly related to how we treat the viewers and how we pay them and service them.
Thanks, Yuvish. I think Yuvish has to leave, so we'll wind up right now. And I think what he shared is something really good, and we can all try to gain something, implement few of it, and maybe we can also grow our organization. Thanks, Yuvish. Thank you very much. Thank you.